Stravinsky, Beethoven and Mozart. It's not exactly a bad selection of composers that we have coming up in Sinfonia Cymru's March concert series. Musical innovation and musical innovators are at the heart of this programme. Yet that said, it's always interesting to remember the quotation from the great artist Pablo Picasso, who once said, "Good artists copy, great artists steal." My name is Sophie Rashbrook, and I'm going to give you a little introduction to the sheer brilliance of the musical thievery that is going on in this concert programme. We'll start the programme with Igor Stravinsky. In 1939, he left behind his native Russia and his adopted European homeland to settle in his new Beverly Hills home in Hollywood. Now, once upon a time, Stravinsky was the wild child of the music world. Of course, he was at least in 1913 when his music for the ballet The Rite of Spring famously caused a riot at the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées in Paris. Writing the danse concertante or the concertante dances over 30 years later, though, Stravinsky was living in a very different world. He was the one who was now being denounced by his contemporaries, like the late Pierre Boulez, for being intolerably old-fashioned, partly due to the fact that he wrote in what's called a neoclassical or classically influenced style. The word concertante, or concertante as in the title of the piece, actually alludes to a Baroque style of performance in which members of an orchestra will take it in turns to play solos one after the other within a particular piece. That said though, it's not surprising at all that 2 years after this piece was composed in 1942, the great choreographer Georges Balanchine, also based in Hollywood, was so keen to collaborate with Stravinsky that he actually staged this piece for dancers. The opening marche d'introduction, or introductory march, could not have been written by anyone else. It has those scrunchy chords, that echo of the musical past, and an irrepressible but kind of irregular pulse that beats through it like a heartbeat, all of which scream Stravinsky's hallmark style. Things get pretty strange in the next movement, thèmes variés, or varied themes. Now, what you'll hear there is Stravinsky further atomizing the orchestra into its constituent parts. You'll hear a kind of bell-like tune coming from the horns and the woodwinds, plucked or pizzicato notes in the strings, as well as lots of ricochet bowing, which does what it says on the tin. It's a strange and wonderful piece, bristling with life and energy. But Stravinsky does leave us wondering whether this is a celebration or a satire of dance and instrumental forms. That said though, who knows what you'll be inspired to do on the night. Perhaps Sinfonia Cymru's musicians will also want to take to the stage and start dancing. It's been said that in 1803, with the opening chords of his Eroica symphony, Beethoven single-handedly ushered in a new era in the history of art and music with the Romantic. He must have been pretty good at writing attention-grabbing openings, because 3 years later, in 1806, he began his violin concerto in an equally revelatory way, although on a completely different scale. With just four notes or four beats on a solo timpani, he begins what is really considered to be one of his most lyrical and romantic works. And this theme of the four beats or four knocks is something that returns throughout this opening movement and often surprisingly dissonant. The orchestra paves the way for the soloist's first entry, and the woodwinds actually give us a preview of this soaring melody that the soloist will later play, so that when we do hear the violinist finally playing it, we almost feel as though we've come home, although of course the journey has only just begun. Now the slow movement is much more contemplative in style, and it has these moments of really beautiful stillness, helped partly by the fact that the string section are using mutes on their instruments, which gives a much more cushioned body of sound for the soloist to soar above. We are jolted out of our reverie though by the introduction to the third movement. Now I think at least the spirit, if not the melody of this, must have been pinched from a particularly raucous dance floor from Beethoven's era. It's a kind of folk dance, but which is in a rondo style, which means that it's a tune that will keep resurfacing throughout this final movement and will probably stay in your head long after you have left the concert. By Mozart's ridiculous standards of musical overproduction, the summer of 1788 really does take some beating. He wrote three symphonies in the course of just 9 weeks, and this wasn't just any old run-of-the-mill music. There's a reason why this symphony is named after the largest planet in our solar system. It is epic, from the opening melody, which is played in unison, to these huge, loud and soft contrasts and soaring melodies in the woodwinds and strings. Now, not content with all of these amazing kind of hallmarks of his style, Mozart then does something else. He steals a melody from himself. Now, in his day, it was standard practice for composers to write what were called insertion arias. And these were tunes, kind of lollipop numbers, for the great singers of the day, which could be inserted into the middle of an opera, often regardless of its musical or narrative context.
Siete un po' tonto, mio caro Pompeo, l'usanze del mondo andate a studiar, andate, andate, andate a studiar.
Now, un bacio di mano, or a kiss on the hand, is one such insertion aria that Mozart composed for an Italian opera by Anfossi. Not content, though, with allowing Anfossi to use it in his opera, Mozart decides he'll have a go too and uses it in his first movement of his symphony. In the second movement, there's another echo from the musical past in the form of a saraband, which is a French kind of courtly dance in triple time, which is often used in the music of Johann Sebastian Bach, who was a composer that Mozart greatly admired. And he takes a very simple tune as really the basis for the whole of his final movement, which is really considered to be the most masterful of the lot. What you will hear is just a four-note tune at the very start, this da 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 da. It's a tune that has been used for centuries, dating all the way back to kind of plain chant motifs that monks would sing in ancient times. And out of these four notes, Mozart transforms them into five or so different variations, all of which are somehow ingeniously woven together in the awe-inspiring coda or finale to this symphony. Now, it's actually unknown as to whether Mozart ever even heard this piece performed in his lifetime. And what's even more remarkable is that there's no evidence even of there ever being a commission. He appears to have composed it just for the pure pleasure. So do come along. We hope you will join us at this wonderful concert where you will hear three musical time lords at their best. Not only have they pinched from the musical past, but they have also, of course, stood the test of time. We look forward to seeing you there. Thank you.